We might need the lights on for this. So back in 2010, I became a Mac. I have been a PC since our family got our very first computer, a Commodore 64, way back in the early 80s. To tell you, that's a lot of years of habits to break. But I adjusted. It's one of the great things about the human mind. It can be transformed. Well, along with my new computer, Apple sent me an iPod, you know, to build my collection. And while I have not yet branched out to the iWatch, though it is quite tempting, I do have my iPhone and, of course, my iPad along with my MacBook. Well, all of this got me thinking about the iWorld. iMac, iPod, iPad, iPhone, the iLife. How's your identity these days? Well, when you think about it, Apple has tapped into much of what our culture has become. All about that unholy trinity of me, myself, and I. But Jesus, actually, I want to say, this isn't anything new. Marketers have successfully persuaded us over decades with every commercial we have watched to tell us how much better our lives would be if we just have that one more product. We can be prettier, healthier, happier, just buy it. And we do, because we have been taught to want more, to want better, to want bigger. Now, in contrast to this iWorld message, Jesus says, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. That's what we heard in our gospel reading this morning. And while it isn't the first time Jesus spoke about money, this encounter begins as a man steps from the crowd and asks Jesus to settle a debate with his brother about their inheritance. Now, Jesus doesn't settle their dispute, but instead gets to the root of the problem. Greed. And to make his point, he tells a parable. The story of a rich landowner who has a bumper crop, an abundant harvest, so much so he asks himself, what should I do, for I don't have anywhere to store all of my crops? But then he says, I know. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. That's where I will store all my grain and all my goods. And then the man says to his soul, soul, you have ample goods stored up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. But of course, then God comes in and says, you fool, for this very night your life is being demanded of you. And then all of these things that you have prepared, whose will they be? Now, I think it's important to note that Jesus does not condemn this man for his wealth. As we've heard said other times in Scripture, wealth in itself is not bad. Instead, the warning is against letting wealth become the focus of our lives, the center. We're warned against idolizing money and our possessions. Perhaps you've heard it said, so often we let our possessions actually possess us. And therein lies the main point of this parable. Just look at how hard it is for that man to think about anything other than himself. What should I do with my crops to secure my future? And in the midst of this selfishness, not only does he not even consider any of the needs of people around him, he doesn't even think that his blessings are a gift from God. No acknowledgement that all things belong to God. He simply focuses on how he can hoard all of his good for his own purposes, for his own pleasures. In this story, Jesus reminds us that the kingdom of God is not about keeping God's blessings for ourselves. Instead, God's design for us is to live a life of trusting God, a life of serving others, of being generous. And this bears reflection for us. Do we spend money in ways that glorify God or that glorify ourselves? Or in the words of Reverend Dwayne Lee, metaphorically speaking, have we built bigger barns for ourselves in order to preserve our priorities over God's? That's what Jesus causes us to think about in this story, both as individuals but also as a community together. What good are bigger barns if the grain that's been stored in them rots with age when there are people who go hungry? What good are bigger barns if there's no livestock to live in them? What good are bigger barns if their costs obstruct instead of advances what's important to God? Because really, God doesn't want us to be in the barn building business, especially if the barns are used to hurt or hoard instead of to achieve God's purposes, God's real priorities. With God, it's never about the barns. It's always about trust and faithfulness and using God's resources the way God wants us to. And that's the invitation that Jesus offers. An invitation to those brothers disputing over their inheritance, and an invitation to us to allow Jesus to change our hearts, to let go of all kinds of greed, to let go of the I world, and be rich toward God. And that's the best part. Because our God kind of specializes in transforming hearts. But it isn't an easy transformation, especially in our culture with nonstop messages that teach us to want more for ourselves. So we have to actively open our hearts to the power of the Holy Spirit, open our minds to let us be changed. We have to look at the desires within our own hearts that really are for selfish gain, those things that pull us away from God. Perhaps the most difficult question that we have to answer is, are we willing to change? And if so, then we need to look for those opportunities where we can practice living lives that are more simple and more generous. I want to go out on a limb and offer you an opportunity right now to step out in faith with your money. I've written a check to the church for $300 because I believe in the ministry of this place. And I challenge you to match me, to support the ministry of Calvary right now in an above and beyond gift. I might sound like one of those radio hosts you might be driving around these days, and there are a couple of those radio stations in their fall campaign, so I'm sounding like one of those. You probably change the channel like I do, but you're all sitting here and you can't change the channel. So trying to do God's work with our hands. Think of how we seek to feed those who are hungry, both spiritually and physically hungry, as we prepare food, meals for the homeless. How we train and connect Stephen ministers and care connectors with those who are hurting. How we gather for Bible study and for prayer. How we offer faith formation programs for children, youth, and adults. Think about all the ways we as a community walk with those who are hurting. How we care for the poor. As we support groups like NA and Al-Anon. As we gather socks and coats for those who are living in homeless shelters or on the streets. How we create prayer shawls and quilts for frightened single mothers or those in hospice care. And how we care for those who are in prison. These are the ministry opportunities where we put our time and our financial resources to God's purpose. These are the ministries that are evidence that the Holy Spirit is working in us and through us in this place. And that's why we financially support the ministry here at this community, to give glory to God and to share Christ's love. So over the course of this morning, I am challenging you to take out your checkbooks and do the same. If we get 50 people to give $300, we could raise $15,000 just this morning for God's ministry. And I'm talking about an above and beyond gift, not your regular giving. So actually, if you write a check, I want you to put in the memo line, above and beyond. Now, perhaps you're thinking, I can't give $300. Well, what about 30? Or 3? But consider this. Consider what amount of money would make you feel that donation in your soul. What amount of money would make you think about this donation during the week, such that you think about your relationship with your money? Now, if you didn't bring your checkbook, you'll see in the pews there are these little green cards. There are some up here as well. Little green cards. You can just write on there, above and beyond. Write your name and write down an amount and bring a check later. But consider offering a one-time gift right now. And then, here's what I want you to do. As you go about this week, I want you to reflect on your relationship with money. And then I want you to decide prayerfully how you will support God's ongoing ministry here at Calvary. Maybe it's one of the many ways you support God's ministry out in the world. But next week, as we have our commitment Sunday, I want you to bring back these cards filled out with a pledge of how you will practice a spiritual discipline of giving God's blessings back to God. Now, this donations that you make over the course of the year, I say it shouldn't put you in the poorhouse, but it should change the conversation you have with your own soul. Jesus invites us to live for today with a change of heart, turning away from all kinds of greed, turning away from the I world, and finding our richness in God.